What nightlights are for? Chapter 5. Something is on the top shelf in my bedroom closet, and I'm too afraid to open it. I am standing on the stepladder trying to find a place to store the bin that holds my winter clothes. The closet in my room is smaller than small, so I have to pack up some of my clothes to put away till I'm ready to wear them again. I try one more time to get the bin to fit in my closet, but I can't push it all the way back because there's a tin canister that's in the way. It looks just like the round cookie tin Grandma always has in her kitchen at Christmas time. Ray, can you help me?
Just a minute.
It takes more than a minute, but finally Ray comes to my bedroom. Can you get that down for me? I point to the canister.
What is it?
I don't know.
Whose is it?
I don't know.
I'm not touching that, Ray says. I think we should leave it alone.
But my bin won't fit unless we move it.
You mean unless you move it?
Ray steps away from the closet.
What if the person who lived here before left it there?
Well, if it was important, they wouldn't have left it.
But what if the person who lived here died and the people who cleaned out the house had no idea that was even there?
I've never thought about who lived here before us. The fact that someone could have died here sends a chill through me. Ray says, if we open it, the man's spirit could haunt us.
What if it was a woman who lived here?
I'm pretty sure it was a man.
How can you know that?
I just know.
I don't know why him saying this makes me want to open the canister even more. Maybe whatever is inside will prove the person who lived there was a woman.
I reach and use my fingertips to inch the canister to the edge. Then I take it down, walk over to my bed, and open it. Two seashells, a postcard addressed to no one, a white handkerchief embroidered with purple flowers, dried red rose petals, three gold hairpins all clipped on a small piece of cardboard with room for one more. It looks like someone took the fourth one off and never returned it. The hairpins are long and have a cluster of silver-toned flowers at the end. They are not everyday berets, or hair clips. They look like something to wear on a special day for a special reason. See, the person who lived here was a woman, I say.
You don't know that.
Ray steps closer to look at the items. He inspects them and then says,
why do you think someone saved these shells?
I shrug. And why would someone have a postcard and not mail it to anyone? And then, I wonder what happened to the missing hairpin.
Maybe she was wearing it when she died.
Ray, stop trying to scare me! Ray laughs an evil laugh. Stop it, Ray, I mean it! I push Ray and he finally quits teasing me. I make up stories about the things we found. Fun stories that aren't creepy or sad. I tell a story about the most beautiful bouquet or of roses the woman was given on her birthday. Maybe a big important birthday that marks a new decade of living, like 40 or 50 or 60 or 70 or 80. It had to be an important occasion if she saved some of the petals, I tell Ray.
Ray says, just to annoy me, I'm sure.
What are you gonna do with all this?
I don't know. Put it on my dresser, maybe?
These shells are so pretty. They shouldn't be hidden in a dark closet.
I think you should put everything back the way you found it, Ray says.
You sound like you're scared. What? You think something's going to happen if I keep it out?
I think it's not yours, so you shouldn't play with it.
I'm keeping them, I say. I put everything back in the canister and set it on my dresser. Ray walks out of my room.
Don't come crying to me when his spirit comes to haunt you.
I close my door, keep setting up my room, and try to forget about everything Ray said. I put the plastic bin of sweaters on the shelf, make my bed, and find a place to hang my nameplate. It's a sign with my name painted in yellow against a purple backdrop. One of the vendors that's at Saturday Market painted it and gave it to me as a gift. And it wasn't even my birthday or Christmas or any gift-giving at all. She did it just because. Mom says those are the best kinds of gifts.
I think so, too. I hang the sign above my dresser. I don't really think about the canister for the rest of the day. Not until it's time to go to bed. All day long, I've been so excited about having my own room, and now that it is time, I'm a little nervous to sleep on by myself. I'd never tell anyone that, though. Especially not Ray. Or Mom. She's in my room, helping me get ready for bed. Honey, here's a nightlight for your room, just in case you get afraid tonight. I'm not a little girl anymore, Mom. I don't need a nightlight, I say. Well, maybe just keep it in case it's too dark, and you need to see how to get to the bathroom. I'll be fine. I don't need it. Mom says okay and gives me her big mom hug, holding on a little longer at the end. Good night. Love you. I love you too. Mom closes the door and I get to bed. I don't know how long I've been asleep. All I know is that a noise wakes me up. I can't tell where it's coming from. I lie real still, eyes opened wide, and listen for the sound again. Nothing. I turn over on my stomach, close my eyes, and try to go back to sleep. The noise comes again. It sounds like knocking or maybe footsteps. Mom? No answer. Mom? More tapping. Ray? Ray, if that is you, you better stop it. You better stop trying to scare me. The tapping continues. Ray? I think back to the tin canister we found. The seashells, the postcard with no note written on the back, the handkerchief and hairpins, the rose petals, hard and frozen in time. Maybe Ray was right. Maybe the spirit of whoever lived here before is angry because we went through her things. Maybe she'll haunt me every night till I put them back where she left them. I'm sorry, I say out loud. I'm sorry for going through your belongings. Just please, please, leave me alone. I promise to put them back. I promise. You promise? A voice says. It's louder than a whisper, but still soft and quiet. I scream and pull the covers over my head. Then I hear loud laughter. And Ray's voice repeating what I just said, mimicking me like a parakeet. I promise to put them back! I promise! He turns the light on and off, making it flicker like we're in a scary movie. Leave me alone! I thought you didn't believe in ghosts. Who are you talking to? Ray, get out of my room! The whole neighborhood probably heard me. Mom calls us from her bedroom. What's going on out here? Neither of us answers. Ray, Ryan! Mom comes to my room, hand on her hips, hair tied in a silk scarf, bathrobe on, no slippers. She looks at me first. What happened? I tell her the whole story, starting with finding the dead woman's things in my closet, and when I get to the park about Ray scaring me, Ray laughs like he's reliving the moment. And then, instead of Mom telling him he ought to be ashamed of himself for being so mean to his little sister, she says, well, Ryan, I told you to sleep with a nightlight. But having a nightlight has nothing to do with Ray being a mean old prankster. Mom goes away, comes back. She walks over to my bed holding the nightlight. This way, Ray will keep out of your room. He can't hide in a room that isn't dark. He plugs in the light, turns it on. Just use it tonight and see if you want to keep it a little longer. Mom flicks the switch on the wall down, and now it is dark with just a trace of light making a path along the carpet. Both of you go to sleep. Not another word out of either of you. Mom yawns and walks back to the hall in her room. She doesn't even make Ray apologize, but when he drags out, good night, she yells, Ray! And that's that. He goes to his room and leaves me alone. I lie in bed. The glow from the nightlight is soft like moonlight. I don't really need it, but I'll keep it since it seems like Mom really wants me to have it. I'll keep it if Ray stays out of my room.